First Chronicles chapter 12. First Chronicles chapter 12. And then when you find that, put your finger right there. Or you can just look on the screen. You don't have to really look nowhere else. After that, we're going to read Deuteronomy chapter 33. And then Genesis, the 49th chapter. And then we're going to begin in Genesis 1 and read all the way through Revelation chapter 22. Oh, man. Sometimes I can't help it. We're not going to be here till about 3:30. That's it. It'll take us a good hour and a half to get through just the scripture reading. I'm just kidding, you guys. First Chronicles chapter 12. Now, if you don't have it or you can't see the screen, just close your eyes and listen. First Chronicles chapter 12, verse number 32. And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. Oh, for somebody that would lead us, that would know what to do. The heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment. Verse 33 of Zebulun. Say that name. Such as went forth to battle, expert in war. It's a root word for experience. Let me just say this to you. Every experience is preparing you for the next great event in life. With all instruments of war, 50,000, which could keep rank, they were not of a double heart. They were not of double heart. Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse number 18. And of Zebulun he said, rejoice, Zebulun, in thy going out, and Issachar in thy tents. They, speaking of Zebulun and Issachar, shall call the people unto the mountain. There they shall offer sacrifices of righteousness. For they shall suck of the abundance of the seas and of treasures hid, where? In the sand. One more passage and we'll be done with this. Genesis 49 and verse number 13. Genesis 49, 13. Zebulun, say that name again, shall dwell at the haven of the sea and shall be for an haven of ships. And his border shall be unto Zidon. I'm going to preach a message this morning entitled Times and Tides. If I could subtitle this message, I would call it The Reward. The reward is in the refluence. Say those words to somebody around you. The reward is in the refluence. Let us pray. Father, I thank you now for the reading of your word, and I ask you to enlighten the eyes of our understanding as hearers. And as a speaker, I ask you to anoint my mouth to say only what the Spirit is saying to the church in this critical and crucial hour that not only the church is in, but our entire country. We look to you for a word. We lean on you in faith. And we say, have your way today. In the name of Jesus, every curse is broken. Every demonic spirit is dismissed. And we thank you for apostolic accuracy in this building. Take over, Holy Ghost. Just take over the service. Have thine own way. Father, we give you praise and glory for what has already transpired in this day. And we give you a pre-praise for what you're going to do for us all week this week. And we say, Lord, if you never bless us again, you've done enough for us to serve you the rest of our life. And we give you glory and honor, and we give you praise now as your people. And we just want to utter these words, thank you. We just want to say thank you, Lord, that we are able to come to church today. Lift up a holy hands without wrath or doubting. We can come to your house, Lord, our heart is beating. We're able to breathe today. We're able to think and comprehend, and we give you praise for that. Therefore, touch every individual name by name and need by need. Have your way in Jesus' name. Thank you for an open heaven here now over this property, over this sanctuary, over every person. Thank you, Lord God, for easy preaching. Hallelujah. Thank you for the spirit of discernment, insight, revelation in the name of the Lord. Let's everybody begin to praise him now and just give him thanks for all he's done for you. Come on, you ought to put them hands together. You ought to lift your voice and praise him. Come on, everybody praise him today. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Before you sit down, high five no less than three people and tell them you're in the right place at the right time today. God has a word. God has a word for you. God has a word for you. Thank you, Lord. I read these particular passages of scripture today in reference to two tribes in particular, specifically Issachar and Zebulun, and we will get on that in just a moment and get into deep explanation concerning what the Spirit is saying to us. As we have gone forth in this particular series, Go and Grow, I pray that your life is changing. I pray that things are becoming more relevant and you are becoming more relevant in your time. I pray that you are maturing in the matters concerning you. I pray that you're not as easily knocked off track as you used to be, simply because you've been sitting up underneath the preach word. Times and tides. When you look at 1 Chronicles 12, Deuteronomy 33, Genesis 49, all of these passages of scripture are in reference to these tribes. Concerning the tribes of Jacob, let me make a few preliminary remarks. The sons represent certain revelation for the church to enjoy, the 12 tribes. Now, as I go forth in this word today, I'm going to preach to you like you're hungry, if you are hungry or not. Okay. And Jesus said, blessed are the hungry, they shall be filled. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to preach like you're hungry. So when we look at the 12 sons, they hold secrets of revelation for the church to enjoy. I've always said what is concealed, and I heard Ron talk about it now on the video, what is concealed in the Old Testament is revealed in the New. So the Old Testament holds secrets for us to be enjoyed as a new creation. Strong stuff. James chapter 1, verse 1 says, James, a servant of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, my epistle is to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. And he says, I send you greetings, denoting the idea that the 12 tribes did not end in Malachi, but they were carried over through the 400 intertestament years from the Old Testament to the New Testament. And now they are dispersed throughout the earth, manifesting themselves in the personality of each local assembly. So when you look at the 12 sons of Jacob, or the 12 tribes, which is actually 14, that's for another place at another time, you must understand that the personality characteristics of those individuals are made manifest and seen in local assemblies today. And we'll take that a bit further momentarily. So when James says they are scattered abroad, it means they are dispersed, or they are resident in certain regions. The Greek word is interesting because it literally means, Pastor Dustin, that God sowed these personalities. He sowed them in certain areas or geographical places. It means to distribute. So God has strategically sown these personalities throughout the earth. Now, our study today is going to revolve around three tribes. We're going to consider Judah. We will converse about Issachar. And we will concentrate on Zebulun. And when I was preparing this morning, I felt inspired of the Lord to tell you these words. There is something hidden that is about to be revealed. There is something that was lost that is about to be found. There is something that was planted that is about to produce. Something that left is on its way back. Something you sent is about to return. Something you have sown is about to be harvested. Something you thought you would never see again is about to show up in your life. It's all coming back. If you believe that, I double dog dare you to give a praise like you're excited about what you are fixing to see in your life. Because you are on the threshold of the most exciting phase that you've ever enjoyed as an individual. You ought to look at somebody and tell them, I can't help but praise him because I see something coming up the road. So when you read Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse number 1, the Bible says this is the blessing that Moses spoke over the 12 tribes. I've rehearsed this for you before, but I will recite it one more time for the sake of being on page with you. So the blessing of Moses is reserved for him as a man of God. He does not have the position as a patriarch to prophesy over these 12 tribes that belong to Jacob. Jacob was the father, and on his deathbed, he called all 12 of these boys together, and he prophesied, predicted to them a future. But when Moses begins to lead the 12 tribes, and he is about to depart from the earth, he does not prophesy to them, he blesses them. And Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 1 says, and this is the blessing that Moses spoke over these particular tribes. Very strong connotation that God has your best interest in mind. In other words, you should never be sitting under leadership that is not continually prophesying over you and blessing you. Amen. So I came here to do two things for you today. Prophesy to you and bless you and tell you your best day is not behind you. Don't frown about your future. Smile about your future. Tell your neighbor, my future looks so good, I should have worn my sunglasses even in church today. So when you read Deuteronomy chapter number 33 and Moses begins to prophesy, he gets to these two tribes, Zebulun and Issachar. And he says, rejoice, Zebulun, in your what? Going. Rejoice in your what? Going. And Issachar, in your tents. And then he says, they, these two, shall call the people to the mountain. The pastor, Pastor Dustin, has chosen for the text of Go and Grow, Isaiah chapter number 2, verses 1 through 3, where the Bible says, and there would be a people in the last day that would come to the house of the Lord, and they would go from the house of the Lord, and they would say, come and go to the house of the Lord with us. So it's as if the two tribes, Zebulun and Issachar, understood that prophetic unction before the unction ever arrived, because they were blessed with that kind of anointing. Are you with me so far? So when the people of God set out in their going, in the Old Testament, Moses was very peculiar, very particular about how they would go or how they would travel. In other words, he didn't stand before all 12 of them and just say, go forward. But he gave specific details on how to travel. And he said, you're going to travel in tribes or groups of three tribes each. And over every three tribes, I will anoint a certain leader to lead those tribes. And he said, Reuben, you are going to lead three. Now, Reuben is important because he's the oldest, and his name means, behold, a son is coming after me. So Reuben is always in the position of anticipating something else is about to happen, to perceive or to inspect. Dan, you're going to be over another three of these tribes. Dan's name means the judge, to plead a cause, to contend with adversaries. Are y'all with me so far? To govern the people. And then the third one, going to be Ephraim. Ephraim, you're going to be over three as well. And Ephraim's name means doubly fruitful. He is the son of Joseph. So you've got Reuben and Dan and Ephraim leading three tribes each. But Zebulun and Issachar does not belong to those leaders. Zebulun and Issachar belong to another guy. His name is Judah. And Judah shall lead Zebulun and Issachar. In other words, when we camp, y'all gonna live together. When we travel, you're gonna walk together. So you're always gonna see in scripture, wherever Issachar and Zebulun were, Judah was right there leading them. Now that's very important because Judah is unlike anybody else. See, Judah has a special anointing on him. His name, we know Judah means praise, but his name means literally to throw or to cast a thanksgiving. So his name means throwing thanks into your future. So no matter what happens in your tomorrows, your thanksgiving got there before you did. So come trouble, trial, or tribulation, you already told the Lord thanks for everything you're going to do, for everything you take out of my life, for everything you add to my life, for everything you trouble me with, or everything you comfort me with. I trust you so much that I can thank you before I ever get there. I just need to know if there's anybody in this building that can go ahead and thank him for a place you ain't never been. Just touch three people and tell them you got a reason to thank him. Amen. So if you can thank him for a day you've never seen, that's an exhibition of a trust you've never made manifest. As a matter of fact, I dare you to throw your hands up and shout, God, I thank you for next year. I'm going to try you right now. Throw your hands up and say, Lord, I thank you for next month. I'm going to go ahead and try you and tell you to throw your hands up and say, Lord, I thank you for next week. I'm going to try you one more time and ask you to throw your hands up and say, Lord, I thank you for tomorrow. Whew. I'm going to try you one more time and ask you to throw your hands up and say, Lord, I thank you for the next hour of my life. I thank you for the next half hour. I thank you for the next 15 minutes. I thank you for the next 5 minutes. I thank you for the next 60 seconds that I get to breathe and live for you. Somebody throw some thanks around in this building. Look at three or four people and tell them, if you don't throw some thanks out there, I'll go ahead and thank him for you because he's done so much for me that I got leftover thanks. I got more than enough thanks. I got an overflow of thanksgiving. If you can't thank him for yourself, I can throw a thank you out there for you. Go ahead and take 2 minutes and throw your thanksgiving straight up in the air and begin to praise him like everything is already procured. Praise the name of Jesus. God is good, isn't he? Now, can I finish this up here because I feel something on this thing. Whew. Now, all of these tribes you see, Hector, have specific compass locations. So you got three on the south, three on the north, three on the west, then you had three in the east. Now I think it to be uniquely conspicuous that God chooses Judah with Zebulun and Issachar and does not put them in the west. He doesn't put them in the north. He doesn't put them in the south, but he says, you guys, y'all gonna be on the east. Because the sun comes up in the east. East is always the sign and side of new beginnings. So when the Bible says in the book of Numbers chapter number 2, it says that he placed on the east toward the sunrise the divisions of the camp of Judah, and they are to encamp under the standard of Judah. Can I stop and preach right there just for a minute? See, Judah has its own standard. Judah has its own banner. Judah has its own insignia. It's unlike any other sign. It's unlike any other flag. It's unlike any other banner. It's unlike any other standard. Judah said, if you're going to follow me, then you're going to act like me. So Issachar and Zebulun, if you're going to travel with me, then you're going to have to travel with a certain anticipation, a certain excitement, and a certain enthusiasm. You're never going to stand by Judah and be silent. You're never going to stand by Judah and be still. Judah's loud. Are y'all with me right now? And he said, we're going to put you on the east side. And watch what he said. And next to Judah, verse 4, Numbers chapter 2, we're going to put Issachar. And next to Issachar, verse number 7, Numbers chapter 2, we're going to put Zebulun next to Issachar, Issachar next to Judah. And when you get down to verse 8 of Numbers chapter 2, the Bible says they will set out first. In other words, before any other group, Joshua, of the three move, the first group to move every time is these three tribes, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun. So nobody else can move until they see them move. Nobody else can go until Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun first go. Here's what we must understand. Praising people do not wait for the problem to stop before they start praising. Hold on. Because a problem will tell you you can't move. But a praise will look at a problem and say, because you showed up, now I'm about to put my praise on and I'm about to make a move. So thank you for showing up in my life, because I'm about to praise him like I have lost my natural mind. Because I know if I praise him, Judah means to open. Some of y'all need God to open up stuff for you, but you won't give him no praise. Can I get down to the literal and practical terminology of this particular word? It means to celebrate. If we've lost anything in the church, it's not our song. It's not cerebral thinking. If we've lost anything, we've lost celebration. If anybody in the earth ought to be partying like there ain't no tomorrow, it ought to be the people of God. Why? Because you're living forever. I'm going to give you about 10 seconds to go ahead and throw up an excited praise. Now I'm going to put you on the east side. Because the east side is the preceding side, the side of anticipation. It's where the sun comes up. It represents first. Judah is celebration. Who shall go up against the Canaanites first? Judges chapter 1, the Bible says, and the Lord said, Judah shall go up first. Why? Because Judah is the commencement praise. In other words, cause cannot really be activated until the commencement begins. Some of you are wanting to know the cause in your life, the will of God for your life, but you won't give God praise for your life. I have never, ever been a quiet preacher. I have never, ever been a quiet praiser. And I thank the Lord for that. Now, here's the problems. Because you are first, you take the initial blow. Yeah, because you break the cycle in your family lineage and you exit the curse first, then you have to take the initial blow for leaving the pattern of a genealogy that's full of problems and curses. But until somebody goes first, nobody else can follow. Why not you? Why don't you be the first one to say, no, I'm not going to be a drug addict ending up in jail or prison.
I'm not going to be broke my whole life. I'm not living in poverty for the rest of my days.
Praise the Lord. So there's an opening anointing on Judah. To open means being in position to permit passage for other people. Being in position to permit passage for other people. To move from a closed position to an open position. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do for the next few moments of time, because I can see some of you are in such deliberation today that your face looks a face of consternation because you are in such deliberation. So I'm going to ask you just for a moment of time. I'm not going to tell you any lies today. I'm not going to mislead you today. I'm not going to deceive you today. I promise you, everything I say to you is coming straight from the Bible. So I'm going to ask you just to give me 15 minutes of you being open to God. That's all. Just give me 15 minutes. And look, psychologists tell you when you're talking to a person and they're listening to you like this. That is a closed position. Some of y'all just went like, did you see that? Some arms just went straight down right there. That's a closed position. So I'm going to ask you just for 15 minutes to be open. When's the last time you walked in church and was open to God? In other words, you didn't have a preconceived idea how service should go. You just walked in, Karen, and you said, God, do your thing, and whatever you decide to do, I'm good with it. I mean, if you want to break out and deliver people from demon possession, go ahead on, do that. Lord, if you want to break out and save people that ain't sick, go on and do that. Instead of coming in here with a preconceived notion of this is how church ought to be. And you're so set in that pattern that you become close to what God might want to do that may be just a little bit different than the agenda you've adjusted yourself to. To get open, you got to be open. You got to think open. I'm just going to ask you to do that. So the first opens the way for the rest. Zebulun and Issachar got used to being in first position. Let me say it again. Zebulun and Issachar got used to being in first position because they hung out with Judah. If you can't get in first by yourself, then find somebody that don't mind getting in first. In other words, if you can't be first, at least follow. All right, let me break it down to the moment we're in right now. You are either sitting by a praiser or a non-praiser. I didn't say they weren't saved. I'm just saying you either sitting by somebody that loves to praise or somebody that ain't interested in praise. Now, I can tell you this. Praise is contagious. It spreads. I would imagine when Moses walked out there and said, now, Zebulun and Issachar, y'all get with Judah. I bet you Zebulun and Issachar said, oh, thank God that I don't have to hang out with Dan because he's judging everything. I ain't got to hang out with Reuben because he's already looking over his shoulder. Thank God I'm hooked up with Judah. Somebody in here ought to thank God you go to a praising church. You ought to tell somebody we might be loud, but we're getting it done. Now I'm going to give you 15 seconds to give God that Judah praise that bust up open in the atmosphere. Bless your name, Jesus. It's the difference in hanging out with a pessimistic person and an optimistic person. That's the difference. And I don't know about you all, I can't stand to hang out with somebody that's so pessimistic. I want to wake y'all up. So pessimistic that every time you start to do something, they give you 10 reasons why that ain't going to work. And every time the church get ready to do something, you got 20 people standing up saying, now we can't do that.
I like hanging out with people that say, go ahead on with it. How can two walk together except they be agreed? Can I get about 25 people that will come into agreement with me that says we are about to go somewhere we ain't never been as a family, as a church, as individuals? Things are about to shift, transition, change. It ain't never gonna happen till we give him praise. And Jesus said, if you don't praise me, the rocks will cry out in your place. In other words, Jesus said, I'm gonna get my praise. And I don't know about y'all, ain't no rock gonna cry out in my place. Ain't no stone gonna be praising him in my position. 15 more seconds, don't look at your neighbor. Give him praise because of what he's done for you. Bless your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Is there any Jesus fanatics, Jesus lovers in the building today? You love Jesus more than anything. Oh. Let me wrap this up real quick, y'all. I'm about done, but I had to deal with Judah. We got to get Judah right. I told you we was going to converse about Judah. Didn't I say that? Now let's look at this next group, and we about to be done. It's 12:15. I still got 2.5 hours. Verse number 18:19, Deuteronomy 33 of Zebulun. He said, rejoice, Zebulun, in your going out. Watch this next group. And Issachar, in your what? In your tents. Then it says in 1 Chronicles 12, verse 32, our text said of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the what? Times. Let me talk to you about tents and times. People that dwell in tents are always in transitory mode. The tabernacle of God in the Old Testament was a tent. And God had it built as a tent, Randy, so that they could take it down. And when the cloud moved, they could move with it. They didn't have to break down a building made of stone and mortar, gather all that up and travel. No, they could break it down, break the staves down, break the curtains down, break everything down real fast and move very, very quickly. And God said, that's where I will dwell with you at, in the tabernacle. You will feel me, experience me in the tabernacle, in the tent of meeting. Tents are very important because they denote the ability to travel at a rapid pace of speed. Transitory. There comes a time to be a tent dweller, and there comes a time to be a temple dweller. When God stops to establish a thing, he tells Solomon, build a temple. But when God is moving people to promised land, he tells Moses, build a tabernacle. I believe we are in a tabernacle season. As a matter of fact, Amos said that God would restore the tabernacle of David, denoting the idea that the first thing that must come back for us to progress is our praise. David is known as the ultimate praiser. He's the father of praise. So the first thing we need to get back in the house is not performance, but praise. So Issachar knows if I'm going to travel with praise, then I have to be transitory. So I choose to live in tents. Because when Judah moves, I want to be able to move quickly. See, that's what happens with rapid revelation through preachers. When preachers come and preach in a mode of rapid revelation, which means we ain't getting our messages from books, we actually pray and open the Bible and study it and say, Lord, show me what you're saying right now. Well, when that happens, see, you can't be preaching to monument people. You got to be preaching to moving people. Because what God's saying today, he could be saying something completely different next week. And we got to be ready to move with what God is saying right now. So you don't have time to sit there and navigate and complicate your transitions. The church asks why too much. God is saying, why not? Why can't I change you in a moment? Why can't I shift your whole life in a 7-day period? And you're so locked into learned behaviors and past patterns, they have become strongholds to your destiny, and you can't even see what God is doing in the very front of your face. I've watched people pray for a thing. God sends it, drops it right here in front of them, and then they talk their way out of the very thing God answered them with. You've been praying about it crazy. It showed up. I want, oh Lord, bless me, help me, Lord, I need it, and it's just coming down, and then boom, God drops it right there, and then you go, I don't know if that's the one. Because we are so used to being stuck in rut syndromes of religion, we cannot move at the pace of revelation. Revelation does not ask you if you're ready to move. Revelation goes ahead and moves, and then looks back to see if you follow it. How does God speak? At the speed of light. And God said, first words ever, let there be light. It's the law of first mention that when I speak at the speed of light. Do you know God can give you one word and deliver you from 10 years of addiction? God can give you one word to set you free from generations of curses. Don't sit there and think about it. Throw your hands up and say, God, do it now and do it in me. So Issachar is powerful, Pastor D, because praise opens revelation. And when praise opens, Issachar moves. He don't sit there and say, start tearing the roof off and get the bricks and the mortar. No, he just strips the tent down and moves. I'm praying for more transitory transition believers that know how to move at the speed of revelation. Now, if you're tired of where you've been and you're ready to get to where God is revealing you supposed to be, I double dog dare you, take 10 seconds and praise him like you just got there. Come on, high five somebody and tell them we going there, baby. Tell your neighbor, I'm taking my tent with me. Because as sure as we get to the next revelation, God's going to give us another revelation. As soon as we get to the next place of glory, Derek, God's going to show us another place of glory. Because we go from glory to glory and faith to faith. How many of you are ready to move quickly? That's why the Bible says, write the vision on the wall and make it plain that they that read it can run with it. When you read Revelation, you can't walk through your life. You got to run through your life. When you're walking in Revelation, you're not just in the doldrums all the time. There's a certain skip in your walk. You ever seen anybody walk on their toes? It's like they know something about to break loose. Everything about Judah and Issachar and Zebulun has an anticipation to it. Man, if we got to church, I remember the day, Mario, folks used to leave their car doors open. We'd have to call their license plate out. ZFK139, you left your door open and your lights are on. Let me finish this. Everybody say tents. Now tell your neighbor one more time, I'm taking up my tent. Matter of fact, tell him my name is Issachar today. And tell him again, you can call me Izzy for short. Come on, tell about three people, just call me Izzy the rest of the day. Karen? Where, Karen? Karen, come up here and sit on this front row, please. Just come and sit right there, right by Charisse. Amen. I need to see you if I'm going to lean on you. Now you say, Bishop, why you make her move like that? Because I need to see her. Woman only been praying for me for the last 25 years. Sit down one more time. Issachar dwells in what? Tents. And he has understanding of the what? Times. He has a revelation of the times. I've said this a million times, but there are people in here who have never heard it, and you need to write it down. Understanding is the ability to recognize how every event in your life relates to a far greater picture. Understanding is the ability to recognize how every event in your life has to do with a far greater picture. Every experience, every encounter, and every event in your life counts because it's painted against a broader canvas than you can even realize. In other words, what I just told you is you don't go through anything by accident. Even if you caused it, God's going to still use it. You got to get to that place of understanding. So the Bible says Issachar were people of understanding. Here's what his name means, Issachar. He will bring a reward with him. Everyone say the reward is in the refluence. And I'm going to get to that later. He will bring a reward with him, or he will bring wages for his warfare. In other words, God will never let you go out into battle and not come back blessed. The reason for the battle is your blessing is on the other side. So when God calls you to war, start looking for wealth. Some of y'all been fighting like hell. And I came to tell you it's because just on the other side of this fight is a wealthy place you have never seen in your life. Everyone say tents and times. They understood their times. They understood the natural times. They could discern the face of the sky. Issachar, theologians tell us, were weather-wise men. Weather-wise men. They understood the political times. They understood the public affairs of their time, the present events and their tendencies. They understood those times. They knew when to plow. They knew when to sow. They knew when to harvest. They understood the times. They were familiar with the times of the holy feast. They knew the appointed times of worship. But the most important about them, important thing about them, is the most important thing about you concerning times. It's not just the understanding of the time, but it's to be able to recognize when it's your time. I need you to nudge your neighbor and tell him I feel like my time might be happening right now. What does our time look like? A time of great confusion. Where do we live? A time of great confusion in our country. A time when the moral fabric of our nation has been torn asunder. A time when racism is trying to make a comeback. A time of rebellion. A time of violence.
a time of protest, a time when the family unit has been changed to what is referred to as dysfunctional units, not families. A time of great tension, a time of great frustration, a time of great insecurity. And Jesus said, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red, but it's lowering. Oh, ye hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. The people of God ought to be keenly aware, acutely discerning of the time we're living in. Why do you sit and watch CNN and go into deep depression? Why do you allow newscasters and media to determine the attitude of your day? Why do you allow who or who is not to dictate who or who is not in any office to dictate your service unto God? Oh, I'm on everybody's address today. We are polarized. Get it. Get that. You are polarized when you got half of a Congress sitting down, half of it standing up, and I don't care who's speaking. You are polarized. You are polarized when people of different color skins are talking about people of different color skins. You are polarized. Get that. Guess what? It's the time we live in. So now the question is, how are you going to act? What you going to do? You going to just join with everybody else? Or are you going to join with the kingdom that's from another world? Do I need to remind you, you are not of this world? You are in this world. You ain't of this world. Touch your neighbor and tell them, understand the time. This ain't new. Don't act like we ain't never been here. Stop acting like you shocked. Come on, Bishop. Stop acting like you can't believe what's going on. What you mean? This is a cycle of time. Can I read it to you in the Bible? Certainly I will. Mordecai goes to Esther, chapter 4, verse 14. And he says to her, if you remain silent at this time, can I explain to you what is about to happen? Haman is about to annihilate the seed of God in the earth. He's about to kill them all. And Mordecai said, if you are silent now, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? Let me remind you why God saved you when he saved you, because he knew you would be living right now. And if anybody's voice ought to be raised with a clarion call of God's praise and a clarion call to people out there to come in here, it ought to be us. Tell your neighbor it ain't time to be silent, baby. It's time to talk about God like you ain't never talked about God. It's time to talk about salvation like you ain't never talked about salvation. It's time to preach the gospel like you ain't never preached the gospel. It's time to declare good news like you have never declared good news. It's time to praise him louder than you have ever praised him.
I'll stop.
Hosea gonna say it like this, Karen. Break up your fallow ground. What time is it? It's time
to seek the Lord until he come and rain righteousness on you. It's not time to be coming to church with a hard heart. It's not time to be living in your house with a bitter spirit. It's not time to be hard-headed. It's not time to be obstinate. It's not time to be like that. It's time to be fallow. It's time for God to break up the fallow ground in our life. We must change our fallow to be fertile. How do you break up fallow ground? The Bible tells you, Judah shall plow. The next verse says, Judah shall plow. There's nothing that breaks up hard hearts like praising. Woo. So Hosea said, it's time to seek the Lord. It's time to break up your fallow ground. Paul says the time is short. 1 Corinthians 7:29, Romans 13, 11. And Paul says these words, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time, listen, Pastor D, to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Dustin. Thank you, Pastor Dustin. Thank you, Pastor Dustin. Thank you, Pastor Dustin, for coming in here and leaning on us and pushing on us and shaking us and waking us up out of our sleep. It's not time for believers to be sleeping. Bless your name, Jesus. Understanding the times has to do with knowing transitions are taking place. Changes are happening. Can I finish now? For real? Issachar understood the times. Is this too deep for y'all? Do y'all want me to start bringing you some milk and chocolate chip cookies? You need some Dunkin' Donuts? You need some Dunkin' Donuts? You want the Krispy Kreme? You want the red light? Go find you a kindergarten church. I ain't come here to play tiddlywinks with you and checkers. You jump here and I jump there. No, I'm about moving a whole family forward. And if that means you get a little bit bothered, I did my job. You get a little bit uncomfortable, that's good. Understood the times. Here's the word. You're going to love this here. Experiences, the times. Experiences, the events. Listen to this, Beverly. The occasions and the opportunities. That's what it means. To understand the times, to understand the experiences, the events, the occasions, and what? Opportunities. You know what a problem is? An opportunity waiting to happen. You know what an impossibility is? An opportunity waiting to transpire. Oh, my God, today. Times in the Hebrew also means evening tides. You ever heard the term even tides? He understood the evening tide or the evening tide. Whew. You know what evening tide means, or even tide means? The end of the day. The end of the day. So Issachar understood when one day was over. The power in understanding when a thing is over is it positions you for the thing that's about to happen. The reason why people can't enjoy new days is because they can't get out of the old day. They won't let it end. Are y'all hearing me today? Some of y'all are living in yesterday. Yesterday ended 3 weeks ago. For some of you, it ended 3 years ago. For some of you, a decade ago, and you're pulling yesterday all the way up into today. You gotta recognize when a day is over. You gotta recognize when a relationship is done. You gotta recognize when that season has stopped. Until you let the day in, you can never walk in the joy of a new morning. Pastor Dustin, I'm going to ask you to let me do a favor. Bishop speaking now, not asking, telling. I'm not talking to y'all about Zebulun. And that's the title of the message. It's all about Zebulun. Right, Fred? I said we're going to zero in on Zebulun. Have we got to Zebulun yet? No. No, we have not. I gave you some Judah. I gave you a good dose of Izzy. But I can't unzip Zebulun for you today. Why, Bishop? Because you ain't ready right now. But hear what I hear. Oh, here come the bishop. I told y'all, give me 5 more years. I'm coming here with that hat on with the feather on the side. I'm going to have a cane and a Cadillac if I need them or not. I'm going to buy me an old, long Cadillac, El Dorado. Oh, watch me. 5 more years. And when I drive it up here, I'm coming in here with my hat and my cane. I don't even need it. I ain't going to do much preaching. I'm going to sit over there and complain. Ain't that what them old bishop do? What you going to say today, son? He ain't saying nothing. That's what them old bishops do. I've heard them do it to me. They receive me an offering. They're like, give this white man an offering. And they count it right there. I know he's white and everything, but give him a little bit more. They wear me out. I love them. All right. Here's what we're going to do. We're coming back to church today. Amen. Yep. Amen. Going to bishop this thing for a minute. At 5:30, we're coming back to church. And I'm going to zero in on Zebulun. Now, come here, Hector. Stand right here because I want you to be my witness. Because people are thinking the reason he ain't going to preach on Zebulun is because he ain't got the notes on Zebulun. Can you read, see number 3 right there? What does that say?
Number 3?
Yeah, right here.
Zebulun to dwell in the honor, habitation to the enclosed of
what's
the
what's that say on the line right there?
Zero in on Zebulun.
Yeah. That's ha, ha, ha. Let God use you, don't let him lose you. I hear the Lord saying this, Pastor D. People that are hungry to discover what Zebulun possesses will be here tonight. Now, here's why I hear it. Now I hear it back up to it. It's the first Sunday of the month. This is the first Sunday night of March. First Sunday night of what? It's the first Sunday night of what? So if you want to know what Zebulun has in store for you and how the reward is in the refluence, you're going to be here at 5:30. I'm done. God bless you. Did you enjoy the message today? Awesome. I hope you did. Is there anybody in here tied to Judah? Is there anybody in here ready to pick up your tent and move forward? Is there anybody in here with a transitory anointing ready to go to the next place of your purpose in life? I need about 30 people to go crazy that you're about to go to from glory to glory. You're about to move from this area of faith to the next area of faith. Come on, y'all. Lift those hands all over this. If you're in here and you're ready to go forward. If there's any Issachar people, if there's any Judah people ready to go higher, come on, throw them hands up and sing.